Welcome, everyone. My name is Olivier Kusher. I'm an art historian and curator of the Bridge exhibition by Welling Tay that's currently at WMA in Hong Kong, as many of you will be aware. I am an honorary associate at the University of Sydney, but also a visiting fellow this year at the Centre for Art History and Theory at ANU. And I convene at the University of Sydney, the Sydney Vision Art Series, for which Yung Ma, one of our speakers tonight, has presented in 2020. What I will do is just present to speakers and then also say a little bit about some housekeeping for the event. Of course, we're holding this discussion in relation to Welling's exhibition, A Bridge, which is currently on at WMA. And these conversations are really something which, when this exhibition, its first iteration was held in Sydney, Welling and I were really keen to try and broaden the conversation around the work and put it into a dialogue with other practices. So on that occasion, we held two conversations, one with Hong Kong-born Australian artist John Young, another with photomedia artist, Australian artist Yvette Hamilton, from different perspectives, looking at the way their work intersected or resonated with this project. So tonight, it's wonderful that we're able to be joined by Yung Ma, who's bringing another perspective as a curator, and particularly a curator who's, I think, worked especially with Moving Image, or is well known for working with Moving Image, to be able to talk about his practice and talk to Welling's practice as well. So with that, I'll introduce Yung Ma first. He's, of course, artistic director of Seoul Media City Biennale 2021, the title of which is One Escape at a Time, and he'll be presenting a little bit about this in a moment. He was curator in the Contemporary and Prospective Creation Department at the Centre Pompidou in Paris, a post created in collaboration with K11 Art Foundation. And prior to that, as many of you will know, was associate curator of Moving Image at M Plus Hong Kong, which is finally opening this week. Congratulations, M Plus. Yung co-curated the Hong Kong Pavilion at the Venice Biennale in 2009, the work of Park Shin-chan, and 2013 with Lee Kitt. He holds an MA in curating contemporary art from the Royal College of Art in London, where he's now based, and a BA from the University of Reading, and has also studied film direction at the Beijing Film Academy, and has at one time, I think, was also going to take on an artistic career, but way back when. I am also joined by Welling Tay, a cross-disciplinary artist. Again, many of you will be familiar with Welling work. She works across photography, video, and sound, and she's interested in the ways we see and present the world in images. Her work's often been inspired by family histories, her own and those of people she meets, as well as archival materials and social environments. So her long photojournalist experience also informs her practice in a variety of ways, both in approach but also a kind of self-critique. I think we'll hear a bit about that in the work this evening. She received her MFA from Bard College, the Milton Avery Graduate School of the Arts, and her works have been collected by museums, including the National University of Singapore Museum, National Taiwan Museum of Fine Arts, Fukuoka Asian Art Museum, Heritage Museum Hong Kong, and the Kiyosato Museum of Photographic Arts in Japan. She's received awards, including the Art Creation Fund from the National Arts Council of Singapore, appointed fellowship from Yale School of Art, and has also been, of course, an award winner in WMA's own photography prize. So that tells a little bit about our speakers. The format for this evening will be, I'll invite each of our speakers to sort of contextualize their practice through a short presentation. Beginning with Welling, I'll just remind people that we are recording the conversation. It will be edited before it goes online, just to sort of keep it succinct. Since it is a relatively small group and we're in a meeting format, our speakers are also fine with people asking direct questions. If you're unfamiliar, at the bottom of your Zoom screen, there's a reactions button and you can raise your hand there. I think you can probably just interject and we should be able to unmute you. I think we can work it out. Otherwise, you're also welcome to put your questions into the chat and I can read them from there as well. Okay, I think that's all of our housekeeping. So I will begin by handing over, welcoming Weiling to introduce a little bit of her project and sharing her slides. Thanks, Weiling.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I'm just going to share. Do you see it? Yeah. I'm gonna talk about the exhibition tonight in that's in Hong Kong called The Bridge. It's kind of, I guess, funny or not funny, because I've actually never seen either exhibition in person. We've put this together online. I guess other people have seen the exhibition in person. This project began with a series of interviews that I was doing with people who had crossed from southern China into Hong Kong from the late 60s to the 2000s. For many years, I lived in Hong Kong from 2000 to 2015. And for a long time, I was very interested in, I guess, the relationships and the families across the border between China and Hong Kong. So in 2018, I started interviewing people, and I guess previously a lot of my works were always based on these interviews, and I would photograph these people that I would meet very often. But I think in 2018, I was having a little bit of a moment, maybe, or for a few years now, thinking, how do you actually photograph in a place like Hong Kong? And also at that point, as I was speaking with people, I felt that the portraits I had been doing of people were feeling a little bit dated. I guess, I don't know if dated is the way to call my work, but that's how it felt like. And so as I listened to people tell me their stories, you know, so a lot of these people who I met were, you know, people that come over, who would have been considered San Yiman in a way, new migrants, and you know, who might have already been, you know, kind of historicized in popular culture, so to speak. So it was a way of speaking about themselves sometimes, adjacent to these popular ideas of who they might be, in a way, kind of conflating that public and that private persona. And as they were talking to me, you know, they would reference that public history, that personal history, and there would be a back and forth, because there was always, because, you know, I approach people and they know it's an art project, they know it goes to public. So it's also that idea of how do I represent myself? And as I was speaking to them and thinking about how I would photograph what I was doing and what kind of images I would use, I started thinking about myself and I guess my position in relationship to Hong Kong and how I looked back, I guess in a way, how they looked back to China maybe, and for myself to Hong Kong, and how I could think about this place that I had left. And so then that began, I guess, the main body of work that's in this exhibition. So the exhibition is called The Bridge. In the Hong Kong iteration, it has four parts. So the main part are the sea prints, which follow a kind of structural form, I think for myself at least, that the interviews take, and I will elaborate on that a little bit. And then there's the video, and there's a, which I also, and then there is a series of 25 prints, and for Hong Kong, there's a sound installation. So in terms of the prints, I wanted to think about my own practice then. How do I look back? How do I think about these images? And also, how do I think about these images that were perhaps photographed initially for a different purpose? You know, so a lot of the photographs in the show were originally made on assignment for news or for features, because I also used to work, I guess I still sometimes do work in journalism. And so it was, how do I remember and how do I think about these things? But also they were also made all on analog film, so mainly medium format film, and also some 35 millimeter film that was earlier period, mainly also slide film. So then for these works, I used my mobile and I re-photographed them, thinking about, you know, with this kind of digital technology that I guess most people use nowadays to make images, you know, how do I remember and how do I look back and how do I reposition myself and the images that I had made from a different time? And I will just talk about these works first very quickly. Am I being very slow? It's okay, right? So one of the, there are a few things in these sequences that are quite important for me. Also to think about how people were, the kind of reflexivity that were in the conversations that I had with people. One of the things was thinking about the past and the present and thinking about how can I think about the past? How can I think about the present? And how can I think about how they are enmeshed and how can I put that into an image? So I wanted the images that I made to reflect the present and the past in a way. This is another installation view of the exhibition. I guess one of the ways in to illustrate, I guess what I was saying is the idea of how do you foreground, what is in the foreground and what is in the background. So for example, in this image, so this is, you can see the title. So one of the things about these sequences is that the titles for me are quite important in that they describe the place or the, this in this case, it was the place and also the project that it was a part of originally, but also the film and the year that it was used. And it, for me, this is a photograph that I made in my study at home in Singapore. I was holding up the film. This was a woman that I met in Lohas Park for one of my other projects. And I think one of the things I like about this photo is that when you first look at it very casually, it looks like it's somebody looking in. But in fact, if you actually look at, let's say, the bottom left-hand side of the image, then you start to see the blues, and the blues actually are in front of the window frame. And then that image of that woman then comes to the forefront and the window becomes the background. So then there is this kind of interplay within the image of, you know, that past and the present going backwards and forwards. An image is something that I was trying to do. This is another installation view, and we had kept the windows, we wanted the windows to be open, because one of the things with the works in Hong Kong was also having them within that kind of infrastructure and architecture of the place. This is another image. Let's see. One of the things, other things that I was also interested in terms of the medium was also the traces and the history of how do you mark and how do you choose these kinds of images that were originally used for another purpose. So there you see the kind of wet markings. Another thing that was very important to me also then was the kind of materiality of the photograph. So in this instance and in these instances, we can see there's the materiality of the actual print, which is a glossy C print. So it's a C print, so the what the material and the image goes, or the photograph goes through, is that it goes from being an analog film to being a digital image to being a C print, which is, it's a digital C print, but nonetheless with a kind of photographic process. So it goes in a loop where it goes from, you know, a traditional process to a digital process, then again to a kind of traditional digital process, which is quite important. So you see the materiality of the image and also then it's extremely reflective. Yeah. One of the other ways I wanted to show is so for example, this image was also thinking about the photographic process in the work. So in terms of looking at the image, not just in its own frame, but also adjacent to the other frames that were taken before and after. And I think one of these things, one of the important things for me when I was looking through all these old images was that, you know, similarly to the people I was talking to where they had difficulty, you know, remembering things and kind of sometimes placing specific periods. For me, it was also sometimes very difficult to remember places that I've been to. And I would look at a photograph and think, where was that? I don't remember being there. But then there were some instances, for example, this, I guess when that protest happened, 2003, where this I remember very clearly, I was near Victoria Park by a building, by the bridge. I don't know if you guys, if people live in Hong Kong, it's there's that building at the side with the chandelier shop downstairs near Bedford, that area. So I was kind of hanging around there. And so with this, there are frames from the same incident in the same area that was Causeway Bay. But then looking at, you know, initially looking at it more as a document, I guess, with a reflection of the current place. But then really going into the pixelation of the re-photograph and the border between the two images. And then I guess moving to a larger extraction and thinking about how you can actually remember something like that. Just want to show a few more pictures that would show that, I guess that would reflect kind of materiality and kind of objecthood of the object, of the photographic object. One of the other works that anchors the show is a video. It's basically just a video of me riding. I took a video riding the bus from Hong Kong to Zhuhai. And this was in early 2019, a few months after the bridge had opened. And so what the video shows is kind of, I guess, almost banal ride that you have, and you just see this endless highway. It lasts about 36 minutes, which is about how long it takes to cross. And this is something that anchors the whole show. This is another work that's in the space. This was something that I had made while I was there in late 2019. You all can see from the title, it was in November. And I guess at that point, the protests were going on. And I think many people were staying at home. And one of the things I was thinking about, I guess, when I was there and experiencing this was the mediation of the screen, I think, in this communal experience, and thinking about what it actually means to photograph an event like that when there are actually so many restrictions, I guess, after the fact, you know, when the image potentially leaves your hand. And so what this is I was in my friend's home and I was staying at home, and you will see here what each image is. It's 25 frames from 1 second of a video. It's 25 frames because it's in a PAL format which I made the video with. And what you have in each individual frame is the video recording of my friend's home and what we were at home watching, which I think that many, many people were also watching, whether it was on their TV screens or on their phones, on their tablets. And it was just what was going on outside on the streets. And this was important for me in terms of kind of passing out that time that had passed in creating a spatial experience of that time passing. But also it was important for me in terms of the image that it was inside a family home. And so what you have here is, I guess, you know, the kids' stuff. My friend had two kids. The kids' stuff in the living room, and where something like that is happening to everybody, and where people and families were watching, experiencing these things. And then also on top of the TV is actually one of my old works, and then referencing back to an earlier work that I made in Kai and Kai. In Hong Kong, I've also added one more work that I guess is not visual, it's auditory. It's a short sound installation of the interviews that I've done with people, but it's snippets of how of people just talking to me and also describing when they come. And it was quite important, I think, for me thinking of bringing the voice back into the space, but also then in kind of fragmenting and cutting up and juxtapositioning them over each other. Thank you.
Thanks, Wei-Ling. So the way that we've talked about doing things here is to now invite Yilma to sort of conceptualize also his recent practice, and then we'll open a conversation. And at that time, I'll invite more sort of questions also between Wei-Ling and Yilma. So I'd invite you also to sort of keep your questions in mind or to place them in the chat at this point, and I might come back to you live as well. But Yong, I'll ask you to bring up your slides now, share your screen. Thank you. Okay. Over to you.
Can you see it?
Yep.
That's okay. Fine. Sorry, I wasn't realizing. Hi. Thank you for having me. So I'm going to talk a little bit about two projects I've organized in relation to Wei-Ling's practice, I think. So hopefully we can have sort of more conversation about that later. The first one I'm going to talk about is an exhibition and screening program that I've organized for M+ when I was still working there in 2015, which is called Mobile M+ Moving Images, as you can see from the poster image. I've always been very interested in the idea of migration or migration, not even the ideas, just about the migration. And I always wanted to do a project about that. And I think at the time I started sort of pitching the idea to M+, maybe even 2013, I'm not entirely sure now anymore, but I would like to try to use moving image as a gateway to address certain aspects of migration, and linking it back to the recent history of Hong Kong as well, which, as I think we all know, Hong Kong's always been a very transient hub. And what started that spark in me as well was because I think at the time there was a lot of discussions in Hong Kong's media, in the press, about another wave of migration, which, you know, in the sense that, you know, echoed what happened before 1997, and so I thought, and also, you know, and also the fact that I think it was around that time that international sort of press and media started to cover what's been happening in Europe and in Australia, and of course, you know, the ongoings of conflicts between America and the southern their southern neighbors, you know. So I kind of wanted to sort of take a look at that through the lens of moving image, and for me, of course, when you talk about moving image in relation to Hong Kong, like Hong Kong cinema is one of those kind of things that I think that everyone can actually relate to as well, especially for the audiences in Hong Kong. So then the starting point of the project became very important, especially, you know, around the 80s. There was this wave of directors, Hong Kong directors, that made a lot of films in relation to migration as well. So out of that collection of films, I decided to utilize Floating Life by Carol Law, who's a Macau Hong Kong director now living in Australia, but she actually makes films for Floating Life like after she's moved to Australia, and the film itself is about a family, a Hong Kong family, that decided to move to Australia, but also with other family members still living in Hong Kong as well as in Germany, and as a very emotional personal reflection, you know, on being a migrant and being Hong Kong migrants was. So I thought that would be a nice way to start the project with it. And here I'm just showing you some of the images of the exhibition. What I think it might be kind of interesting, because Wei-Ling talked about the window, the show was staged before M+ had any physical buildings, permanent physical building. So we had to actually rent spaces to stage the exhibition. And so this was actually a commercial building in Causeway Bay, completely empty you know, commercial building, and they had windows all around it, and you know, for movie in the show, I think that was meant to be a big window. But I thought, you know, instead of actually just building walls around it, I thought it'd be actually quite nice to bring the conversation of the outside, which is Hong Kong, the actual Hong Kong, back into the show to make the conversation and visual dialogue. So we actually just applied filters on the window to darken the sunlight so that, you know, still be able to see all the works in it. And I actually kind of, yes, I can say that I like this image a lot, because here you have a work by Dominic and Sophie Foster, titled Central, which is a personal meditation on the nature of Hong Kong. And so you see, which was made in the 90s. So you see the 90s Hong Kong, whereas behind it, then you see the Hong Kong in 2015 at the time. So I thought that was actually a very interesting connection. I'm just going to go through a couple more images. I think I'm going to move on to the next project because of time. So here I just add the views of the exhibition. And the show was actually partly a collection display as well. So some of the works were already in the Empress collection, whereas others were selected for the project specifically, but many of which actually entered into the collection after the exhibition as well. So the other project that I'm going to talk about is the Seoul Media City Biennale, which is still on at the Seoul Museum of Art, and we opened the show in early September this year. As mentioned by Olivia, the title of the Biennale is called One Skate at a Time, and the entire project itself is inspired by ideas of skateboarding. And what is actually very, very interesting was that, you know, on the day of the press conference, which is the day before the opening, the museum director came over to me and she was like, you know, actually Koreans don't really quite understand what escapism means. I was like, really? And then Weiling actually earlier asked me about that a little bit as well. So it's actually kind of quite interesting, because for me, I thought escapism was actually a very, sort of everyday idea that people can actually easily understand, but perhaps that's not the case. So I think maybe we can talk a little bit more about it. But for me, when I think about escapism, I mean, the immediate association that I make is with popular media. And here, again, I'm using, I guess I can call it moving image work, which is a TV series called One Day at a Time that was produced by Netflix and aired between 2017 to 2020. It ran for 3.5-4 seasons ish, but because of the pandemic, it got stopped or cancelled. The work of the TV series itself is actually very conventional, and it's also a remake of an earlier American sitcom from the 1970s, which is also called One Day at a Time. What's interesting here is the fact that I think we can talk a bit more about this later with Weiling as well. Was again, it's about family. It's a family living in Australia. In Los Angeles, and it's a Cuban American family, 3-generation Cuban American family living under the same roof, and it's about the ups and downs. It's extremely conventional. You know, it's got the laughing tracks and all those kind of things that you get from sitcom. But at the same time, through those or underneath those laughing tracks, they do actually address very, very serious subject matters like migration, racism, sexuality, gender, gun violence. And that's actually the source, really the starting point for me to frame the whole project, which is actually because the fact that when you think about escapism, often we think of the people that enjoy or partake in escapism as being daydreamers. They're somewhat sort of aloof a little bit, and it's they're slightly detached from the reality. But what I'm trying to argue is the fact that perhaps that is actually another way of looking at escapism, if we can reimagine our relationship with it and using it as a device actually to navigate, to connect, and then to a certain extent to confront the reality that we're living with. And I think One Day at a Time, both alliterations of One Day at a Time actually have managed to do that, using laughter as a way to actually address very serious socio-political issues. Here, I'm just going to quickly go through some of the images, but I think another thing that might be interesting in terms of conversation is the layering of the images. I think I tried a little bit with the moving image show in Hong Kong, but I think here I sort of amplified it quite a bit. And also, I think the fact that the framework started with migrant family, I think, is my way to actually expand from what I did before as well in terms of addressing issues and subjects that are beyond migration. So here, actually, you have work that actually tackle various different subject matters that's beyond migration, but under the same youth of escapism. So as you can see, it was quite deliberate at that, you know, I didn't really build that many walls at all, which I guess it's almost suicidal when you think about putting on a show that is very moving image heavy, but somehow I hope that we managed to actually convey the idea of layering the images and try to build up different narratives through that. And sorry about the qualities of some of the images, because I took them with my mobile, so they're not amazing, but hopefully I did give you a sense of the space. And so it's very important for me, I think, you know, for example, in this image, we have a work by the Hong Kong comic book writer, artist Chi Hoi, which is a slide projection installation, and that you can, but then also you get a sense of what's beyond that wall as well. And I think that's actually a very important way for me to connect all the work together in the space and actually to provide the audience a different way of experiencing the exhibition as well. So this is actually just behind Chi Hoi's installation. Thank you. I think I should stop here, and then we can maybe talk a little bit more about some of the ideas that we raised.
Yeah, no, I think there's already an interesting sort of resonance between different issues. You've talked about layering, and I'd like to come back to that. Before, as we were preparing, I said that I'd invite you, Yong, to sort of pose your question. You've sent a few questions through beforehand. And so I'd invite you to sort of now reconnect to what Weiling was talking about in terms of her project through one of your questions. And then I'll come to Weiling and then I'll invite everyone to kind of join in the discussion.
I think the first question that I got from William is very general, which is about your overall practice, you know, because I think Olivier has mentioned it during the show, and you sort of talked a little bit about that as well, which is your interest in migration, but also family histories. I think those two things are very important in terms of how I try to envision my projects as well. So maybe you can share a little bit more about your interests in those two areas.
Migration and family history. I guess one of the things was that I think for most of my adult life, I was a migrant in a way, because I wasn't living where I was brought up, and I was away from my family. So then family was something that I was thinking about quite a lot. I think in terms of the Hong Kong context, what had interested me quite a lot, and I think that had perhaps started my interest in migration, is that idea of that border between southern China and Hong Kong, simply because it's so complicated and the identities are so complex, you know, in terms of that push and pull, in terms of economics, in terms of how then that affects how you think back to a place. I don't know if I'm being very vague when I say this, but so that it was that kind of I think also then this is much earlier on when I was in Hong Kong, where, because I was a foreigner, so then it's always then when you start perhaps with, not start with, but then when you are perceived in a different way, so then you ask yourself, what is the right way, or what is the way that is, that changes how someone looks at you or sees you, right? And so that's what something that I was thinking about. But also then thinking back to Singapore, because over the years I've also done, I guess, work in terms of migration or a kind of displacement maybe across the border in Malaysia, Singapore, and also with my own family. I think that one of the things, one of the reasons why I work a lot with family issues maybe, is that it's that for me, the family unit is kind of a starting point in that politics that you have in a much wider societal space, right? And it's just how do you negotiate with the people who are around you and next to you that can really be extrapolated to how do you negotiate with a much wider social sphere. And so that for me was also quite interesting, but also then how then the family for many years then creates this expectation or this obligation or this responsibility or this need, and how that then drives, you know, many people's actions, I guess myself, my own included. So I guess in that sense, for me, the family and migration has always felt very, very linked. Also because when you have to provide for your family and you look at the options you have, you know, that also drives migration. So there are a lot of these issues that, for me, seem they're quite personal, and I kind of like that place, that starting point for those things.
I should also add, actually, the project, so A Bridge, is sort of an extension of an earlier project called The Other Shore, and it's referenced in one of the works that Weiling showed, but there's a project that, again, I curated Weiling's originally in Canberra, actually. And that project was based more on a younger generation of mainland Chinese migrants to Hong Kong. And so there, again, you had these sorts of cross-border relationships. And in some cases, it's there's migrant stories of many generations and, you know, fleeing for safety, et cetera. And yet in the case of these young mainland Chinese migrants, it's often, you know, professional choices and opportunities, education. And in some cases, there's really, you know, cross-border families. I think that's one of the interesting things about family as well, is that it's a foil in some senses to the state-led narratives that tell us that our borders are, you know, secure and then they're not porous. And especially coming from a place like Australia, that's a narrative that's reinforced all the time. You know, we decide who comes here. Despite the fact that the reality, of course, is that people, you know, live lives that blur those borders all the time, you know, and families, particularly in places like Hong Kong, and I think in Southeast Asia as well, and elsewhere, their family, you know, family trees kind of, you know, cross all of those borders. And I've seen that in some of your earlier work as well, Weiling.
I think that also then with The Other Shore that you were talking about, I think that sometimes it also illustrated that decision to go to Hong Kong for many people was very pragmatic and very practical. You know, it's a place that's close so their parents can keep an eye on them, you know, and then it's a place that's, you know, in the mid 2000s when they changed the education, you know, policy in terms of where people can choose their universities, it was Hong Kong's one of the options. So it becomes a very pragmatic decision that really influences these shifts in the kind of social dynamics in the place and the politics of the place also.
I'm also so curious because I was kind of thinking about it already, but do you see parallels between the relations between Singapore and Malaysia when it comes to Hong Kong and southern China part of Hong Kong, southern China part of mainland China, and that and whether you have actually attempted to do a similar project in Singapore as well?
I have done kind of cross-border projects between Singapore and Malaysia simply because my family is originally from Malaysia. So I was born a Malaysian, even though I was born in Singapore. And then I was naturalized as Singaporean at a very young age because my mother worked for the government. I think that there's a very, very different power dynamic between the two countries here than you would have between China and Hong Kong. So then in that sense, there is no comparison in, in terms of, I guess, you know, the very personal kind of family relationships, you know, when you talk about, you know, how you lose touch with your family or how the kind of distance changes and things like that. Sure, I think, but then I think that is also like a case by case basis where, you know, how do you stay in touch, right? What is important in a, what kind of family relationship is important and what does that mean? But I think there is no comparison.
On that point, though, I know, Weiling, you've done earlier work during a residency in Pakistan, for example, and some of that work was also about cross-border relationships because of partition between sort of Pakistan and North India. And did that project actually change what you were thinking about in terms of cross-border sorts of issues and histories? Because obviously that's a context in which the border is intensely political and people's memories of crossing borders, etc., is very fraught.
I think that in the end, for the few people that I met, I know, I think the disclaimer here is that I was a foreigner, right? So then in a way, but also thinking about doing work like that, where even though in the end, over 3 years, I was going back and forth between to Pakistan, to Karachi quite a bit. Nonetheless, I was a foreigner and an outsider. And I think that really played a role in how I was looking at the place, you know, where I think thinking of a place like Hong Kong, Singapore, it's a very different relationship. But when I was talking to people there, it was, again, I guess it was a very personal aspect I was looking at. It's how do you think about family? How do you choose to go? How do you choose to come? And often those decisions with the people I met specifically were because of parents, because of husbands, because of wives, because of children. So then it was, in that sense, I think that was what it was. I wasn't really looking into any larger geopolitical aspect of the thing. But nonetheless, you know, it kind of creates it speaks to a kind of longing, and it really speaks to a kind of rupture that you know, is where that many people are touched by.
Mm. I'd like to come back to the idea of family, because I'm interested in the way that the, you know, media is also a reconstruction of a kind of firm ground that may not be there in the present, and family is another sort of experience of that in some ways. But hopefully I can explain a little bit more about what I was thinking. But I'll first sort of turn to you, Weiling. I know that you had a couple of questions for Jung as well. Do you want to pose one of them?
I think I might shift it to, because I think one of the things we were talking about yesterday when we were talking about your exhibition that you had in Seoul was also that you were thinking of other mediums to include in relation to media, audio and mobile image and photography, but you were also talking about painting and sculpture. And so then I was wondering about what the relationship, those mediums, what is the relationship between the mediums? You know, how do you think about it, that you felt that you really wanted to, but I guess in the end you didn't?
Well, the reason we could, well, not that we didn't, but it's more like we couldn't, because they were just too expensive to move around during the pandemic, so we just couldn't afford them. You know, that is the reality, and I think that is the reality for a lot of going to be the reality for a lot of the exhibitions going forward, I think, you know. But I think we sort of talked a little bit about that already yesterday in terms of the Biennale itself. Yes, it started off as a media art Biennale 21 years ago now. But I think that a shift happened halfway through, you know, that became much more about contemporary art. And I think the idea of media, depending on the edition, depending on the curator, directors, the idea of media has been reimagined every time, I think, you know. So in our case, we really sort of expanded the idea of the media in relation to popular media. That's why, you know, I spent quite a bit of time talking about One Day at the time, because it is actually a way. What I didn't mention during the presentation was that actually, besides escapism and migration, family histories, and all those kind of subjects, I've always actually been very interested also in popular media as well, and the relationship between popular media and art. And what's more, even more important for me is I'm trying to understand the power of popular media. I think, you know, I think what we do actually the reach and the audiences are often very limited, to be very, very honest about it, right? And whereas I think there are many actual examples and cases in history that, you know, popular media actually has made real impact in our social and political lives. So I'm trying to, so not just looking at the framework of escapism within popular media, but also trying to look at certain devices that they use, that they employ to try to extend and expand the reach. And that's one of those things that we try to do, I think, with the Biennale a little bit. But of course, you know, I think with the pandemic, everything became a little bit more difficult to do. But at least for me, it was actually a very interesting attempt, you know, to animate certain aspects of popular media beyond the subject matter itself. And I think when it comes to selections of works and also organization of space, for me, it's really just about the works rather than media that we're looking at. I think, you know, for me, it's the practice of the artist in the work itself, and how they actually, when they come together, what kind of experiences they might actually convey to the public in the space. So it's not really about picking or selecting certain kinds of media per se. No, it just happened. I think, you know, for example, there's an artist that I really want to her paintings, because I really love her paintings, and I think that would actually bring a certain kind of presence in the space as well. But in the end, they were just too expensive to ship. Mm. So that would just, you know, I have to make that choice to live with that.
I think it was interesting that you, when you were talking about the power of popular media, let's say, because I guess in terms of photography, let's say when you think about an audience, you know, you cannot but help know that the audience has been influenced by how you know, how I guess people have been conditioned to look at, let's say, news media, or look at how you're conditioned to go through the internet, newspapers or other ways, and how that really, that way of perception and viewing is then really, that is then brought into the gallery space, right? And so then you can't divorce that kind of that aspect, that popular media aspect or that popular culture aspect from the quite cube space or the contemporary art space.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, also the fact that I, at least with this project, I think I was very conscious about providing entry points for the public as well. So at least in my head, I thought escapism and popular media would be very sort of accessible entry points for the public to get to understand what we're trying to actually convey, because the exhibition, also actually most of my group sort of presentations, I don't actually organize space in the thematic kind of format. It's really about experience of the space. So I think by actually providing this kind of simple conceptual entry points, that will help the audience to try to sort of engage with the exhibition of the work better.
Can I ask actually to what extent there was a kind of conscious a historicity perhaps? Because you're talking about popular media, and I wondered, because, for example, with the presentation of Chi Hui's work on a slide projector, you know, I was wondering about the choice, because the slide projector also has a connotation of a particular time, which now, of course, is pretty much beyond most people's everyday experience. Or there's, I thought, a very interesting, subtle but effective, you know, position of a TV monitor as almost like a karaoke screen, you know, at an angle, sort of, I don't know which work that was, But again, when I saw that, I immediately thought of a sort of karaoke screen and like particular ways of experiencing media. And of course, the use of sort of specific sort of cube monitors and their position in the space as a spatializing of the media, even in your moving image show. And I wanted to ask about this because in Abridge, I think the relationship of the image as object is something which has been really fundamental to the development of the C-type prints, for example, to the spatialization of the 25 frames of video. There's really a kind of exploration of the medium and its genealogy, etc., including this loop from the analog to the digital to the analog. And so I wondered in the way that you've presented the work in One Escape at a Time, how much was that driven, you know, by the artist? How much was that a curatorial kind of negotiation as well? Because there's a kind of history to the medium that you seem to be presenting as well.
Yeah, sure, of course. I think overall, very deliberate decision on the curatorial part, I think, you know, but at the same time, you know, like, it's really kind of case by case situation with Chihoy, for example. I mean, the work was an earlier work, and that has always been shown as a slide projection installation. So, and the fact that, you know, because the work actually includes about 80 or so slides, and some of which are actually old Hong Kong postcards, there were actually sort of when Chihoy sort of found the images, I think some of them existed as slides already. I think that actually prompted his decision to actually turn that into a slide projection installation. So in that case, that was inherent within the work. But I think we then deliberately made a decision of building a wall that is actually slightly sort of sculptural almost in a way that is actually in between the spaces. So a lot of those were very deliberate, and I think for me, because I think it's just the fact that it's not about when you enter into exhibition, whether it's a moving image exhibition or not, I think it's not just about the act of seeing or looking, which we talked a little bit about that already earlier, that, you know, I think the focus has been on the looking and seeing, the visual. But for me, when we enter into exhibitions, it's very important to remember that, you know, we actually experience them through other senses as well. And I think that actually, that's why I think what Wei Ling was saying about, you know, one of the quotes, which is, the space frames the way the image is encountered to make the image also tactile, embodied, and atmospheric. It's very interesting for me. I mean, for me, because I always say, like, for me, it's about emotive response from the audience to the works. And I think it has something to do with the atmospheric and the tactile and embodied as well. I don't know whether Wayland would agree with me, but I to me, yeah, it is very important in terms of providing the experience that's beyond the two dimensional in that sense.
Yes.
Do you want to go in? I'll let you think about that. I'm conscious of time. I do want to, I've got another question, but I want to sort of invite people to pose their own questions, either in the chat, or if you'd like to pose directly, you know, I can please turn your cameras on. I think you should be able to do that, and I can unmute you. While you're thinking, while you're taking that invitation, I'd like to ask both of you about nostalgia, because here I was just talking about, you know, historical media. And I think in Welling's case, certainly with this project, we talked quite a bit about, in some ways, a resistance to nostalgia. And I think the fact that we needed to even talk about it seems to recognize the nostalgic impulse in some of this kind of media. And I wondered, in your case, Jung, whether this, you know, escapism is nostalgia also, you know, a form of escape for your project. How did you navigate that? And Wei Ling, maybe you can say a bit about what you were thinking in regards to nostalgia after Jung?
I think for me, I think I do also try to step aside from that as much as I can, because I think nostalgia often, at least in today's context, often and in relation to Hong Kong as well, I don't know, that is often seen as something that that provides an alternative, an ideal version of a future that never materialized. The thing about this is the fact that I think in certain works that I've worked with, for example, in the movie in the show with Dominic's work, that was the 90s Hong Kong, and was filmed with, if I remember correctly, a Super 8 or maybe a 16, I can't remember, but one of those analog film techniques. The graininess of the image actually inherently conveys a sense of nostalgia, whether I like it or not, whether I can change that or not. I think that's that already immediately in terms of being seen by the audience. So that's why I sort of stuck with it and tried to frame it in a way that is this floating screen that actually is not anchored anywhere. And that's just image, the fleeting that actually, from my point of view, would actually speak quite well with the quality of the image itself, the nostalgic quality of the image itself. But actually by giving the contemporary version of Hong Kong just beyond it, through the window, hopefully that could be a way to counter the nostalgia that, you know, this is actually fleeting image that we're looking at, which is not reality. So
that's interesting, because there you're talking already to that layering, and Weiling, you've mentioned, you know, layering as a sort of strategy of bringing the past and present together. Is that something, you know, how did that develop in the series that you were working on?
I think that it was that I think it was really important that it wasn't just looking back, that the importance of the present, you know, it's just how does the past influence how I think about the present, mm-hmm. or how does the present influence how I think about the past in that way. And so I think I want there to be that back and forth and the back and forth between the two times. Just because, you know, you don't want, or I don't want, you know, because I think one of the things is also that it's film, right? It's analog film. And, you know, people look at it and, like Jung said, there is this assumption when you see certain types of media or of photographic media or film types, even colors, that really already conjure certain emotions. And I think to be working with the medium, it's just how can I push back against that, and how can I think of a way to remember for myself that it was, as I make these images, that is meaningful, that can help me think of that past from the place that I am in now. And I don't simply mean that geographically, but also as a person. So then I feel that it is really important that that moment in time in that photographic object is situated in a kind of specific context, whether it's geography, let's say Singapore also, or time and you know, all these different things that are happening, because they're not singular, right, these moments. And I guess when you think back, when you think about nostalgia, when you are longing for this place, often when you long for a place that is no longer there, right, in a sense. So it's just like, how do you mitigate that in a way?
It seems to also register a kind of distance, and distance is something that I think is interesting in both of your practices. I welcome questions once again. I know we're sort of talking amongst ourselves, but I'm imagining that people have comments or questions of their own to either Jung or Weiling, either in the chat if you'd like to put it there, or you're welcome to sort of turn on your audio or camera, or raise your hand. There's various different ways that you can engage.
I think that going back to also then, I guess, as people if they have questions. Going back to what Yong was talking about, also then commenting on in terms of the kind of tactility and the embodiment of an image, I think for me, one of the things that was important in terms of making these photographs now and in terms of including the photographic object in these work, the surface, you know, I was showing that I wanted that kind of tactility where you look at the surface and you understand what it is. And with those pores that you see, you understand the time. And so in that sense, that then that tactility provides another level of thinking about the past and think about that history and think about the maybe the environment that this thing has been in, you know, in a way. But also then in terms of embodying, for me, I guess when I think about these things, maybe sometimes I'm a little bit literal, but you know, when you create an image where there is a surface or a texture within an image that makes me feel a certain, so for example, you know, a while back, I had one of some of my other works where this video of this person sitting there and the wind is blowing on his sleeve, right? It's a very subtle thing. And you see the sleeve moving a little bit in the wind. But then for me, at least, I chose that image or that section of video because it made me think I can feel that wind. And so it kind of, it moves what is inside the image out into me as a viewer. And I that is something that is quite strong for me when I see an image that can do something like that.
Mm. Yong, I know you had some more questions about Welling's professional practice. Do you want to ask?
Yeah, that'd be interesting. I think the reason that it's, well, okay. So first of all, the question is, when I met you in Hong Kong, I remember that you were telling me that you were working as a professional photographer at the time as well. So beyond your artistic practice, or besides your artistic practice. So I just wonder whether that experience, because that, I think you worked as a photojournalist for a while as well, whether that that's had an impact on your artistic practice in terms of subject matter, but also the form as well.
I think working in photography, so I worked in photography as a photographer. I have also worked as a photo editor. So I've worked for Western Media commissioning work. So thinking about, you know, news often or features in terms of an editorial capacity. And I think that has actually over the years been quite important in helping me think about how images circulate and how and why they are used for some instances. And in that sense, they kind of feedback into what I'm doing, I guess, in my art practice. Just because, you know, when I think about the processes that lead to a certain image, let's say that's used for a news story, you know, and you ask yourself why, I ask myself why, oh, I see how pictures of a certain news event is being circulated or what types of images are circulated. It makes me, I guess, think about how then do I want to position my work not as a counterpart point, but then thinking about how then I am also influenced by what I see and what I consume. So for example, the work with the 25 frames, that came about because I had been in Hong Kong one interviewing people and it had become harder and harder just because I guess people were becoming, it was harder to get people to meet, I guess, at that point. And so when I was going on, you know, you see so many of these images of what was going on then online and everything. And I was just asking myself, what does it mean? What does it mean to actually make a photograph and then put it online or publish it or something like that? What does it contribute? And that I wasn't so sure. And so that kind of, in the end, I guess I also made an image because I made the video that is in the work, but I guess it's an indirect image because then I was thinking about how we were all experiencing in a way what was going on around us. And I was wanting to think about the mediation that was happening with the screen and the mediation that was creating this communal experience that was kind of isolated. But then at the same time, it's together with everybody else. And I really didn't, and I want that at the point, I guess I want you to think about that as a counterpoint to what you would see in the news, because it really does reach into your home and your family where you sit next to your children.
Mm-hmm. The reason actually I sort of wanted to ask the question was because Olivia was talking about Zhangjiao Town's practice yesterday, Taiwanese photographer Zhangjiao Town, and that how even though his works, a lot of them, especially the early works, they're quite abstract, but also the characters are very detailed, giving you the time and location where the photos was taken, which some aspect you've done that as well with your titles, so you can actually really imagine, if you know Hong Kong, for example, you can really imagine the location where the photo is taken. Even when you were talking about Causeway Bay, the bridge next to Victoria Park, I was like, I was kind of thinking to myself, like, okay, there's some quite a few bridges there, which one? And then you were like, oh, no, that shop. I was like, oh, yes, I know which one you're talking about. And the reason, anyway, sorry, I tried to get to my point. The point is, as far as I can remember, I think Zhangjiao Town also worked as, perhaps not a commercial photographer, but worked for a TV station for a very long time as director and editor.
And a photojournalist.
Yeah, in different aspects. I don't know whether that has something to do with your decision in terms of how you present even very abstract images.
I wanted to, I think, have the image or think about, I think some of them are abstract, but many of them are not, because I was, I think, quite conscious of that kind of layering in that past and present. I was very clear that I wanted the information in terms of the title that acts as a caption, right? I wanted the place to be very, very specific. Sometimes I think also then that kind of layering or that interference in terms of reflections and things like that make it difficult to see what's in the image was also for me thinking about how it is actually very difficult to remember what went on during these times and during these specific periods or during the time when I took the photo. But also then it also creates a space, I think, an openness to see, because there are like in some of the pictures where there are parts of the picture where you see and you kind of know what it is, but then the rest of the image you don't. And so then they also then create reference points then within that tableau in a way that can help you go in and out in terms of think about what that memory is, I think.
I want to actually use that as a segue, this relationship to sort of doing something different with the image, to June's question. So in the chat, we have a question here. Could you speak more, and this is actually for both of you, about the atmospheric, given the specificity of your aesthetic or your curatorial decisions? So could you speak more about the atmospheric, the idea of atmosphere? And I'm gonna extend this question a little bit because we've talked about affect and the sort of effective presence of being in the space. Could you say more about your curatorial decisions, for example, Jung, in terms of that?
It's something that's, from my point of view, it's very abstract, actually. What was actually very interesting was that, during the process of putting the Biennale together, especially the exhibition of the Biennale together, I wasn't able to go to Korea, so everything was done. And I think the team in Korea was somewhat frustrated with me because I think they were used to a certain kind of curation that was very thematically driven. So each section of the exhibition should have a theme. Especially given the architecture of the museum as well, the spaces are quite disjointed in that sense. And I never done that, and I told them I wasn't going to do that. So, but then I think, you know, they're wanting to justify a lot of the curatorial spatial decisions in terms of that. But for me, it's actually that really about the experience in terms of providing something. I guess, I mean, we could call it atmospheric, but for me, it's more the tone, the texture of the visual and emotional textures of the exhibition to the audience. That is the very important aspect of it. I think because through that, I think we can connect with the works beyond the rational. And I think that to me is important because often it's not about understanding the work per se. It is actually having the connection with the works and with the exhibition. That's actually very important for me.
Yeah, I think I agree with Jung in the sense that I can use as an example, maybe the video that hangs in the Abridge, you know, where it was really important that it's in a space that's not dark, where it's kind of this glowing object that casts a kind of light on you know, the things around it, and where that it's small enough that you actually have to get closer to it. And so it creates this, and it's this floaty object. So it creates again this feeling of, and you're looking, and it's just this endless, I guess, right? No, it's not endless. It's 36 minutes, but it goes on for a while, and it lulls you in a way until it starts flashing. So it creates this mood and this space to think, I think, or reminisce or whatever you're doing in your mind as a viewer. But then you are on this journey where there is a direction, but whether or not you know where it's going is another thing, right? But then you are going somewhere, and it creates again this feeling and this mood.
I have another question actually about the audio work, and this is a question that's asking, I guess, about the relationship between audio and the visual sort of processes. So they say, I want to ask about the sound voice element of the WMA show. I remember the voices on the other Shaw exhibition site, which was sort of visceral and powerful. Wondering how Welling approaches sound in this show, or the formal and material qualities of the prints or tactility that you've just said are playing the role of sound instead. So I think that the question has kind of picked up on the relationship between the sort of material process in the prints and what you're doing in the sound. Could you say a little bit more about that? Because my interest in this question is also, Jung, to your point, do you also think about the relationship between works as kind of resonating with a similar sort of feeling or atmosphere? And this is, you know, I want to put that idea there and allow Welling to address this question.
I think in terms of the sound work that's in the show, and it's also where, you know, it is in a side of the exhibition space. It doesn't take up a lot of space, so to speak. And the voices and the anecdotes, let's say, they're cut into very small sections such that they're not in a way fully informative in an arc or a narrative, a full linear narrative arc, let's say. So then you have a lot of these voices that are layered over under each other. And so that for me was something that was, I was trying to kind of put in relationship with the works, where you have a kind of layering also and a kind of fragmentation in that past and present. But then wait, there's a pause here. I think that they work, the one of the things with the sound work also is that it is actually intelligible. So then if you actually stand there under that thing, you can listen and understand if you so wish, as if you want to stay for the entire thing. Nonetheless, I guess I try to make it a little bit difficult in terms of creating a narrative that is not linear, a narrative that echoes across different voices, I guess using a kind of repetition of a kind of, you know, recursiveness between the different people's stories. I think that's what I was trying to do. In terms of that relating to the images in the show, I think it would be more with also with this sequence, I think, in terms of that backward and forwards in the image that is that was made. But also I think one of the things for me that was quite important that we didn't talk about is that it's the prints actually made with glossy C print. So then what it is that when you stand in front of it, you see yourself. So then your reflection actually gets mixed in with the reflections that are in the image in the photo. And then and so then this, again, this kind of loop that you're in that I wanted, then that you also have in the voices where there is, it's not a loop, but then it is kind of going like that. Yeah. I don't know if I'm answering the question.
Yeah. For me, it's interesting with the video work in this show, although there's not necessarily, there's a layering of some of the images, which I think we haven't talked about. So at different intervals, there's like a flash of some of these images that were made in a similar process to the C-type prints, but weren't included as prints. So they sort of come up in at particular times. But the audio in the video for me really grounds it in the present. So although there's this sense of an endless kind of journey and the monotony of the bridge and the infrastructure, the fact that you can hear people just talking on the mobile phones, kids eating, and kind of, you know, you get a sense of a family trip, people chatting in Cantonese or Mandarin. There's a sense of very mundane, everyday, present reality that again creates in a way a kind of layer that brings you, you know, that again sort of brings the past and the present together. We have a couple of more questions. I'll ask one first. That says, I'm struck by your presentations where there are various moments, and this is, I guess, for both of you, seeing past things that made them think about how objects' works also look back at us in exhibitions or different situations. I had that experience looking at works in a bridge, and this is something that happens often with Weiling's works, they say. Can you share with us moments where your experiences or practice objects or the works are looking back at you? Have you had this sort of experience of the work or the object looking back at you or sort of returning your gaze? Is that something that informs your process? Is that something you're thinking about?
Is this for Jung?
For both of you.
Sorry.
I believe. Or not.
Well, it's very hard for me to say because I think I'm one of those characters. I get quite involved with presentations already. I don't think the works actually look back at me. I mean, to be very honest, I don't think so. I don't think that way. I think I often just emerge through the audience perspectives and how they actually see the shows. But I think it's more perhaps relevant to Weiling's practice in that sense.
Weiling, do you want to?
I guess when in terms of like having works, thinking of works, objects look back at you, in it's also in terms of what does this ask of me, right? In that sense, if I'm interpreting it correctly, what is asked of me when I look at this, or when I experience this, or when I watch this. I guess I've done this with some other works in terms of the even very simple things, like, you know, when you have a video installation of my uncle sitting. It's like, how do I ask the viewer to look at the video? Do I ask you to look up? Do I ask you to look down? And so then in that sense, it changes the positionality of the subject, you know. How do you see a subject? I think that maybe that is also something I think in photography is quite important more and more, or not more and more, but in general, you know, because you have, let's say, people photographs and you know, people are aware of being photographed, and they know that often or some often not, but then they know that this is being taken of their image, and how do they look back at the characters that is doing this? And so then how then is the viewer looking back at that object that looks at them?
This question, although I don't know if this is what they were thinking, but this question makes me think about when we were working on the Other Shore project, the work took the form of light boxes, and some of them were light boxes on a wall, but many of them were mounted as to stand in the space. And one of the reasons for that was Welling was talking about creating an encounter with the image. And of course, you know, encounter is, you know, it's a meeting of the image, again, as an object in the space. Although it was very different to the, you know, there were straightforward portraits in some ways, but nevertheless, there seems to have been already this interest in, as you said, sort of directing a particular or inviting a particular relationship to the image as more than a sort of two-dimensional, you know, piece of information. And so when you were talking about, you know, the video of this, you know, with a wind in the sleeve that seems to transgress the two-dimensionality of the medium and have a sort of visceral reaction or invite a visceral reaction in the viewer, that there seems to be a progression of this process in your work, which I think is interesting to sort of recognize through this question.
I guess also then, let's say, for example, the 25 frame work that's in the exhibition, where then how is the audience or the viewer asked to experience this time or look at this time, right? Where then you are not asked to experience this time in a temporal way, but you're asked to experience this time in a physical, spatial way. So then in that sense, I guess in terms of the installation, again, toward that and how it's installed, it requires a certain kind of movement, requires a certain acceptance of that contract. If you want to look at me, you have to do this, right, in a way. So then I don't know if this is what she's talking about.
Moving people around the space. I'm going to skip actually to the last question in our chat here, which is somewhat similar to the second question that was there. And that's, there's a thanks for the presentations and conversation, but I noticed a consistent interest in both of your artistic and curatorial practices, respectively, in the interplay between background and foreground, frame within a frame. Can you talk more about the motivation to embed photographs and moving images within a broader environment, or perhaps how you think about how you go about doing this? A frame within a frame. I think that's an interesting point. Jung, maybe to you first.
I think I think because I've always been very interested in the fact that, you know, I think nothing is singular in that sense, that, you know, narratives and visual that are all multiple and holistic. And I think that is, for me, a very important aspect of how we experience and see things in day-to-day lives as well. And that's why it is actually, I think, perhaps it's a response to that, to what is actually around us today, and that I think I would like to bring that back into the exhibition spaces, but also it is actually an attempt to really try to encourage unexpected conversations between the work as well. Well, a conversation that I perhaps have for myself, or even the artist person, but it'd be interesting, I think, you know, to just pursue the works in a certain way that would actually perhaps encourage that to materialize.
And wearing?
I think similarly, it's this just idea that, you know, nothing is singular, and where then we are constantly influenced by, you know, place or time or, you know, your experiences before, you know, it might be conscious, it might be unconscious, but nonetheless, it influences how you see something. And so then within the exhibition space, let's say, the kind of layering that you have between, let's say, different works, or between audio work and a still photograph or a moving image, I think it induces connections, you know, in people, and so then it helps create narratives or even potentially create an image in your mind of something else or a part of that history that is maybe in the photograph. So then it feels that it's quite important that the space holds all of these together, so that I don't know. It's also just it's that there's a specific context to every single one, and they're all kind of linked, right? And so then it's not. I don't know how else to do it. Maybe I don't know how you take one of the pictures out of that context. And so I guess the thing is, like, when you take something out of that context, what are you doing? It changes it entirely. As an art object or as a document of a time, right? But then when you have these other pictures or these things around it that speak to a different time and place or different motifs that you're doing, then they all come together to create these different narratives within the space, which I kind of think is quite fun and like to do. And it's also quite important, I think.
The other question that I had left aside is more specifically about, you know, why and how you started re-photographing things. And I wanted to connect this to a comment that you made earlier about feeling that your earlier work had seemed dated. You used the word dated sort of with hesitation. But I'd like to kind of to go there, because when we were talking earlier and with Jung, you know, the question of timeliness kind of came up, and currency. I'm interested in, you know, this idea of currency of images. You know, what makes something feel current or timely or somehow relevant to our time, and how you were very aware from, you know, the beginning of the project that there was this issue of a potential disconnect between the sort of aesthetic or the approach of your earlier work to the particular time and place you're trying to work with, and how that connects then to this specific question about how you started to re-photograph things. Could you say a little bit more about that process, I guess, and the underlying sort of feeling or motivation?
I guess in 2018, when I was starting to think about what I've been doing for so many years, and also then think about Hong Kong in that time, and I guess it's also my experience of Hong Kong, right, in the terms of the images that I was seeing. So then more and more you see a kind of, I was seeing it more in the news, I was seeing, or you see it on Instagram, you see it on social media. So the type of photography, I felt that was changing in how you would imagine, or how I was imagining Hong Kong. And so then in terms of, you know, what I have been doing before. So much earlier, I was very much working with portraiture also. And also there was also film. So then it, 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 there was a specific type of frame, specific type of color in terms of that type of analog film, specific type of, because of the camera that was used, specific type of framing and pose and stillness to the photograph that, that for me, in terms of a kind of trajectory in photography, kind of really did speak to a time that was past. So just, you know, as a photographer. So then it was then thinking to myself, what is appropriate? And I'm not sure what is appropriate, but then also then thinking about this kind of circulation of photography and more and how it was being used in terms of social media, in terms of selfies, in terms of, you know, your hand phone, right? Where everybody is a photographer these days. So how can one think about photography then like that? And so then I was very interested in using this as a tool to think back at what I've been doing before.
Hmm.
Yeah.
As a kind of rediscovery or?
Rediscovery, but not really a rediscovery, but a repurposing maybe, or also then, because, you know, the phone, it's quite advanced, but at the same time, it's extremely limited. You know, you can't, it's all automatic, right? So it's just like you get what you get almost in a way. So then there are a lot of restrictions, which I thought was quite interesting. And it's also how most people now see the world, you know, how they make, what they make of the world is through film. And so that I really wanted that in conversation with, you know, let's say photographs that were made, you know, for dissemination, for news, and for, so then it's like the kind of positioning of you know, of the photograph becomes very different, even though like it's the original information might be the same.
And the fact that you're doing that, to me, kind of, it's almost like you in terms of trying to overlap the images, like, you know, actually imposing a new image in a way that is a different texture and different tone onto the old image. So perhaps it's got something to do with that, then the layering. It's almost building a document that actually has the layers. I don't know whether, you know, they should do it again with perhaps a new kind of technology, and then you can just build on top of that.
Yeah, I think that also because, you know, something like these kinds of tools, they are upgraded so quickly that your technology really changes. So they actually speak to a specific time even, right? Let's say this was popular in, let's say, 2018 or 2020. Now it's iPhone, 11, 12, 13, I don't know what it is. But so then it's a different technology again. And so then what was difficult for me to do and what are some of the things where my phone couldn't get close enough to my film, and then it creates a certain type of image. Back then, I would have no problems now. You know, one of my friends was showing me a picture she took of a mosquito with her phone, and it's pin sharp. You can, you know, so then it's just the technology keeps changing. And I was quite interested in how then this technology at that time when I was making it, how it could intervene with, let's say, a picture of the past and also an object, a photographic object that is pretty much a predecessor, really, you know, of this tool.
Mm. And you've pushed that in some of your prints. You've really pushed that to its limit, where in some of the prints there's a kind of fragmentation, like visually the image is starting to fall apart with the process of pixelation that becomes completely abstract and in some ways quite seductive, because you have this, you know, very lustrous kind of, you know, rich color of the C-type print and the smooth reflective surface, etc. It becomes, you know, a beautiful object in an interesting way.
Yeah, but then on the other hand, it's also quite exciting to know that a little phone like that can make a 130C print where it's pin sharp on the surface and where it can actually be blown up to that size, which is also like some, I think, in terms of pushing how you can make a fine art print, so to speak.
Mm. We have one last question, conscious of the time, to Jung. Do you have a similar return to your own earlier curatorial works? And if yes, what does this do? How does this manifest itself?
No, I don't think so. I don't think I have I have returned to my earlier project just yet. But I think because I've always actually very in, I've always been very interested in the idea of structures within the curatorial practices. So I think that I tried to do that a bit when I was at M plus, not so much ever since, you know. So, but perhaps at some point I would like to go back to that into structuring certain format that would actually perhaps not being the person providing the content, but rather having a structure in terms of how we can explore certain frameworks.
Do you mean in terms of a narrative sort of structure, or
could be narrative, could be a thematic structure, or I found that interesting because often then you because there is a structure, therefore you actually understand even more how the audience reacts or behaves within that framework. And for me, then that's actually very interesting, helpful in terms of thinking about what can be done in the future.
Can you give an example, actually, when you talk about that? Sorry, I'm trying to understand when you say structure and then how.
Yeah, sure, of course. Sorry, I'm being a bit late. For example, the screening series that I sort of organized for M plus, which is for M plus screenings. I'm actually not sure whether they're still doing that. Probably not anymore. But at the time was like, you know, the scale of it. You know, it was always over a long weekend, from Friday night to Sunday night. So a combination of different types of moving image work, so not just feature films or documentaries or artist films, but also it was actually kind of, I don't think I managed to do that, but I think the intention was to bring in, like, you know, music videos and maybe TV or maybe using YouTube, you know, clips and all that into the series and try to form thematic. Each one is sort of freestanding thematic narratives, you know, each weekend. But then the formats are always repeated throughout the location and time and contents in terms of actually trying to explore a relationship with the audience and trying to understand what would be the right way of actually presenting this sort of very diverse materials to the general public in a way that so that's what I meant, I guess, you know, in terms of structure. Sort of, I've always been quite interested in that, and hopefully I'll be able to try to do that again as a project.
Thank you, Yung. And that, I'd like to extend our thanks. So thank you, Weiling. We're kind of up for time, but we've had quite a few questions in the chat. So thanks to those who've also been sharing their questions. Once again, I think on behalf of all of us, I'd like to thank WMA as well and Agatha for bringing us all together and organizing, supporting this conversation. And Yung, especially for joining us from your early morning. It's been really great. As I said, this is being recorded, so it will be available online in some form in the near future. But that brings us to the close. So thank you all and take care, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
All right. Thank you.
See you.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks, Tintin. See you.